Pennies on a Dead Woman's Eyes by Marcia Muller. Narrated by Susan Boyce. Part 1. The Victims. Chapter 1.
At first they were going to kill me. Then they changed their minds and only took away 36 years of my life.
The older woman, perched beside me on the guardrail of the road leading to the telecommunications tower at the top of Bernal Heights. The wind gusted across the barren hillside and loosened tendrils of her white hair. The pale afternoon sunlight transformed them to a shimmering spiderweb. She stared toward the spires of downtown San Francisco, eyes narrowed against the glare. Smog blanketed the Bay Area today, from the eastern hills to the city itself, making the panorama look like an old-time sepia-toned photograph. After a moment, she added,
"Only took away 36 years, and my husband, my child, the entire middle of my life."
I waited, not wanting to interrupt the flow of her thoughts.
"And all the time I was innocent," she said. "They kept me as long as they did because I wouldn't admit to it. Wouldn't express remorse or tell them what they wanted to hear. If I hadn't almost died of a heart attack, I'd still be in prison."
I'd expected the claim of innocence, but now that she'd made it, I had no immediate response. I'd never been one for snap judgments, and I certainly wasn't going to make one in this case. When I didn't reply, she faced me, fixed me with an insistent stare. Her eyes were a curious translucent aquamarine, sunken deep in their sockets and edged with pale lashes. I shifted on the guardrail, pulled back slightly. The woman, Lis Benedict, and I had climbed the hill from her daughter's house on one of the steep little streets below. Doctor's orders to walk vigorously once a day, she'd said. Plus, the house was small, and she couldn't stand the confinement. In truth, I preferred to talk with her in the open. The murder for which she'd been convicted had been an unusually vicious one, involving multiple stabbings and mutilation, and, though old and frail, she had an aggressive, temperamental manner that made me uneasy.
"Miss McCone," she said, "you have no idea what it's like to lose that much of your life."
"No, I don't."
"The worst thing is that you become permanently stuck in the past. This old woman who exists here in the 1990s, this embarrassment and guilty burden for her daughter, she isn't the real me. The real Lis Benedict is still back in 1956.
"And the years you spent in prison?"
"A bad dream that I'm still waiting to wake up from."
She gestured at the cityscape below. Almost all of San Francisco was visible, from Hunter's Point to the Golden Gate Bridge. Ironically, one of the few places we couldn't see was the exclusive Seacliff district south of the bridge where the murder had been committed.
"Look out there,"
she commanded.
"In 1956, most of those downtown skyscrapers, including the hideous pyramid, weren't built yet. So I simply don't see them. That ugly red tower on Sutro Heights, I ignore it. But once, there was a huge oil storage tank on the far side of Potrero Hill. For me, it's still there. Playland at the beach, Fleischhacker Pool, the city of Paris. The landmarks of my youth are gone. And yet I still see them."
An unusual mindset, I thought, but probably not uncommon for newly released prisoners. I considered it for a moment, tried to imagine how it would feel to return to a world that had been altered by a span of nearly 4 decades. She seemed to take my silence for lack of understanding. Thrusting her face close to mine, she asked,
"Am I making myself clear?"
Again, I shifted away. "Yes, you are. What would it take to bring you into the present?"
"I'm not sure anything could."
"Then why pursue this?"
"I told you before. For my daughter's sake."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.